Welcome to the house of our God. Perfect song, praise team, perfect song. We will not be shaken. Well, it's Wednesday night again. Here we are. Huh. Yeah, it's good to be in the house of God. Brother Mark, how you doing? So good to see you. All right. Glad to see you. Brother Mark. That's all right. He's like, oh, don't acknowledge me. We're going to acknowledge you. You know, as the body of Christ, you know, we are taught through Scripture that we are the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ. You ever hear Scripture like that? We are the body of Christ. We're His hands. We're His feet. We're the body of the invisible God upon the earth, right? We're also His eyes and His ears. So that means that God sees life through our eyes. That means God hears life through our ears. Which is extraordinary because there's a certain oneness in that. Like God gave us birth and He created us so that He can experience life through our eyes and through our ears and through our bodies. Do you find that fascinating? I do. And you know, just as you fellowship with one another and you enjoy life through different perspectives, so God wants to enjoy life through our perspective. Isn't that amazing? God's that big, yet He descends into our bodies. But then the opposite is equally true. God wants us to see life through His eyes, and He wants to hear it through His ears, right? And that's really significant because to see life through the eyes of God, it's real change. It's an absolute change. I think of the scripture in Haggai, where God says, and I think God is speaking these verses to us as of late, that He said He shook the earth before, but He said He's going to shake again. And He said this time when He shakes, He's not only going to shake the earth, but He's going to shake the heavens as well. That whatever can be shaken will be shaken. So take comfort. If there's anything that's shaken in your life, it's okay. It's not the kingdom, because you can't shake the kingdom. Amen. So if anything's being shaken in your life through whatever's going on in your life, I guess it's not the kingdom, and it's supposed to be shaken, and it's supposed to go. Right? Because sometimes you say, well, why am I so shaky? I guess it's something got to go. And then the only thing that will remain is the kingdom of God, as Scripture teaches us, which is unshakable. The only thing that will remain is the kingdom of God, which is unshakable. Praise God. Praise God. Because it takes God for us or to allow us to see life through His eyes. That means He's going to change what we think, what we believe. And only a God can do that. And He does it through a shaking, where the things that we thought were absolutely right in life and sure in life and true in life. I know God changes your earth. He changes your circumstances. He changes your surroundings. That's Him changing the earth. He does that all day long, right? But when He says He's going to come and shake the heavens this time, He's going to change what you believe about God, about life, about each other. Because He will see life through our eyes, but He says that we will see life through His eyes. And as we read our text tonight, I believe that God is doing that. I believe that God is causing us to revisit these scriptures of old and causing us to see it through His eyes. And when you see it through His eyes, the absolute entire meaning of the scripture changes. Have you ever experienced that? When you read it through a different lens? Even when you see God as a loving God rather than an angry God, the tables are turned. What I believe has drastically changed many times in my life. How about you? Right? And it will always be that way because God is unsearchable. You can never discover Him fully. So therefore, God will always, always, always shake you and change you and me. So tonight we're going to be in Genesis 9, and let's see. We're going to talk about Noah and his three sons because we went through the flood, and now Noah and his three sons are going to repopulate the new world. And what we discovered in past teachings was that what we see in Noah is similar to what we saw in the very beginning, because it is a new beginning. So we see lots of Genesis 1 and Genesis 9. It's like a whole new beginning. And I want us to see Genesis 9 through Genesis 1, and I want us to interpret it through other scriptures as well. And once again, there's a lot here, but we can only speak specifically to what I think God wants to show us today. So we might miss 20 things, but just hit one thing here. It's okay. I really think tonight what we're doing with our passage is, as usual, I think God's going to give us a broad stroke just to kind of change the way we look at things, and then maybe he'll fine-tune it in the future. So let's look at Genesis 9. Usually when you answer one question, like a million more come with it, right? It's usually the way it is. So let's just answer one question tonight. So let's see. Well, let's read verse 1, and then, because I want to start with that, because that's important. And then our text is going to be 18 through 28. So, Pastor Dad, would you start us? Praise God. Amen. The word of the Lord. We're going to hit one aspect. We might do this passage again another time or two because we're not going to hit all of these things. I'm interested in that last verse, you know, but I don't have anything on it yet. But I'm interested in that last verse about Noah. So, or the last two verses. Okay, guys. This is a fairly well-known passage. It's about... when Noah and his three sons, does anybody know Noah's three sons? Ham, that's easy to remember. Shem, and then Japheth. That's the one that might catch you. Ham, Shem, you think you're talking about, I always think about the Three Stooges. But then you got Japheth in there. All right. What's interesting is only one of Noah's grandsons is mentioned, Canaan. And even when it mentions the three sons, it says Ham, the father of Canaan. So that's significant, of course. We know that the Israelites dispossessed the Canaanites when they came into the promised land. Let's see here. And then when you look at this passage, by a raise of hands, I'm curious. Have you ever heard this passage before? Please raise your hands. I'm curious if anyone's read or heard this about this. Okay. You know, there's so many ways that this can be interpreted. And usually, have you heard many different things about what really transpired in the tent where Ham looked upon the nakedness of his father Noah, you know? And I don't even want to get into all the different analogies or theories regarding it. I find most of them are far too carnal. Some of them are downright disgusting. And I don't think it's God. If I'm revolted by it, I know it's not my God. There must be... And there always is. There is absolute spiritual significance here. There is nothing carnal about this. You can read this carnal all day long, but it's a spiritual book. And you know, God speaks to us in metaphors, in symbols, in these stories, right? So there's a story inside the story here. So what I would like to do is I would like to go back to Genesis, beginning. And see where Genesis 1, 2, I think it's Genesis chapter 3, where Adam and Eve experienced nakedness. So I want us to see the similarity. Noah starting a new world, and you see that nakedness was discovered and covered just as it was at the very beginning. Nakedness was discovered and covered, okay? So let's read Genesis 3, and then we'll try to interpret through Scripture. So whoever has not read, if you'd like to read Genesis 3, let's read 7 through 21, or whatever you got there. Okay. Genesis 3 is interesting because here it also talks about nakedness in regard to God and mankind. Before we start to interpret Genesis 3, I did want to read Genesis chapter 9, verse 1. It's right there in your notes. Look at it with me. Genesis chapter 9, verse 1. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 words. 7 words. It said, so God blessed Noah and his sons. What does it say? So God blessed, you got it. Noah and his sons. You shout that out. So later on, we talk about these cursings. Let's not get confused. We need to understand certain things, but also know that God did bless Noah, Ham, Shem, and what's the other guy's name? They're blessed by God. They're blessed by God. All right. So let's look at Genesis 3. Now, what happened after Adam and Eve took of the tree in the garden? By the way, I believe Scripture tells us, I want to put a new image in your head, that it was a fig tree, not an apple tree. Fig tree lines up with Scripture. So when they ate of the forbidden fruit, what happened to Adam and Eve as verse 7 tells us? It says their eyes were opened and what? They knew where they were naked. So, the fall, if you will, and we'll define the fall. The fall, if you will, did not make them naked. The fall made them aware of their nakedness. So in their nakedness, there was absolute perfection. Perfection is broken when you become aware of the nakedness. And you can read through Scripture, as I can read through Scripture, and nakedness talks about sin, separation, a certain fallenness, if you will, not being covered, if you will. But nakedness did not come from eating the tree. They were naked already. Nakedness was already there. What came from eating of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was that they became aware that they were naked. And then they wanted to cover up and they wanted to hide. So I want us to see Scripture through the eyes of God. I want us to see brand new again. I want the heavens to be shaken by God himself and let them be shaken. Because believe it or not, if God wants to shake you and he wants to shake what I believe in and what you believe me, the kingdom of God that's inside of you, Scripture says, it cannot be shaken. So don't be afraid. What is real and true will never be shaken out of you. The only thing that can ever be shaken out of you is what can be shaken. Yeah, right? Good, man. So nakedness is part of perfection. That means there is, and we've already described that even in regard to sin, if you will, and forgiveness. You see, the way that sin is atoned for is through forgiveness. Perfection comes, hopefully this is clear enough and not boring, but perfection comes not by us stop sinning. Perfection comes by us forgiving the sin. And then the cycle is complete. That's how God operates. When Jesus Christ went to the cross, he didn't make sin evaporate from the earth, because, you know, just look at your life. Huh. And I'll look at mine. Fair enough. But what did he add to the equation? Forgiveness. therefore came perfection. Perfection does not come from you stopping what you're doing. I don't know, God's in charge of that. You know God's in charge of that because you tried and failed, as I have. Perfection comes not through stopping doing certain things. Perfection comes through forgiving them. How do you bring perfection into the lives of others? By you getting them to stop what annoys you? By forgiving them. That's pretty powerful. That's God thinking. But you see it in the garden. You see it from day one. Nakedness was there. What came through eating of that tree was the awareness of nakedness. So how we handle the awareness of nakedness is important. And I think that's what we're talking about in Genesis 1 and Genesis 9. We're talking about what this nakedness is and how we handle this nakedness. Right? I think so. Because what did Adam and Eve do? What did Adam and Eve do? Let's pause and stop that phone because I know everybody's distracted. That's all right. Okay, so Adam and Eve, it said that they became aware of their nakedness and they covered up. Now they had the wrong covering, right? Because you cannot cover yourself. You cannot make up for the... Don't be afraid of the word sin, because sin is separation from God, and that's what you and I still have in our lives. Huh. Okay, so sin, you cannot... Oh my goodness. You cannot do enough good deeds to take your sin away. You know that, right? Now you and I, in our natural thinking, when I sin, I believe that forgiveness will come when I distance myself from that sin. You know, like sometimes as a human being, I have a hard time accepting forgiveness instantaneously. Like I can't have forgiveness right away. I got to suffer first. I mean, it can't be that easy. That's our natural thinking, right? I got to pay for this. I have to stay away from God, or I do. I don't know what you do, but sometimes I do what Adam and Eve does. I go high for a while. I don't feel that certain closeness. I feel, maybe you feel what I feel. I don't know. Right? And then we think we can atone for our sins by doing good. By, like, if I get my act together and I stop doing that, then I have atoned for my sins. And you can't cover your sin. You can't pay for your sins. You can't forgive your sins. You cannot make good for all of the wrongs and bads you did in this life. You could never make up for it. There's only one answer for everything wrong and broken that you have done in this life. And there's only one thing that can be done, and it is forgiveness. And it comes from God Almighty. Praise the Lord, because sometimes it don't come from each other. That's the God's honest truth. But I think God wants to develop this in the people. Right? That's the plan, you know. He wants to develop this in the people. And God's working on that in our lives, right? I mean, I don't think we're there yet. So in Genesis 3, let us see this. Let us see that nakedness was not the issue. What happened was our awareness of nakedness and then how we handle it. So God handled it with his own covering. God said, I will cover you. Beautiful. When Adam and Eve fell, God said, without hesitation, delay, without separation. Remember, he came to talk to him that day. There was no separation. No separation. In the eyes of God, in the mind of God, there's no separation. He knows you're naked. You were naked the whole time. The whole life you're naked. Or you become aware of your nakedness and then you want to hide from God. But he says, you've been naked your whole life. I can tell you a billion things you did wrong and you didn't even know. Amen? I could tell you how you offended, you know, all the people you cross paths with, and you don't even know. Because sometimes we are deceived, and we don't know. We don't know the offenses that we walk in, because we're deceived a lot of times. Scripture does say that, right? So it's not our nakedness that's the issue, because God covers our nakedness. It's our awareness of the nakedness that has to be dealt with. And when we become aware of our nakedness, God quickly wants to let you know that you can't make up for it. You can't fix it. You can't cover it. You can't work yourself out of it. All you can do is accept the forgiveness, the covering of God. And know this, everybody. God always has you covered. He had you covered before you knew you were naked. He's always covered you. You were covered with his glory. Covered with his glory. Now, you can apply that in a physical way. I know there's many things in life that God spared me from. Like, nobody found out, nobody knew I did it, and I didn't get in any trouble. Now, maybe some of you are like that. Like, God's covered me many times. And God's specifically told me, he said, Mike, you didn't get away with that. He said, I covered you. I said, thank you. Thank you. He said, there's more coming, Mike. He always says that. He always says that. And I've told you before, and I'll tell you again, you know, so many times, you feel God nudging you or calling your name. Maybe when you're in the midst of things that you shouldn't be in the midst of, and like God still calls you and he's nudging you. And it's not, he wants to pull you away from that, but I think primarily what he's telling you is, no matter where you go, he says, I'm still here. I'm still here. No matter what you're doing, he says, I'm not leaving. Not leaving. Still here, Mike. Still here. We see the nakedness and we can't handle the nakedness. That's why most of the times he doesn't allow us to see it. But he wants us to be changed and see how nakedness is truly atoned for or covered, so on and so forth. So now, okay, before we go back to Genesis 9, look at Genesis 3 again. Remember what happened with all this? Remember God said, God said to the man, he said, because you have done this. And what did Adam say? He said, the woman. And then he talked to the woman, and the woman said, the serpent. So God said, okay, serpent, you will be on your belly. Said, woman, you will have pain in childbearing. He said, man, you will work the ground by the sweat of your brow. It said here, cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Okay. But what these elements were a process to be restored to the blessing. God said, anytime the blessing is missed in your life, and that's by us walking from God, if you will. God's always there, but it's us in our awareness is walking from him. He says, you will have travail, and with pain you shall produce children. And God says, but the one that you will produce will be the godly seed. And the godly seed is the one who's going to save you. So these things that God put in place were implements to get them back into the blessing. You fell, I'm going to give you this, this, and this, because it's going to bring you back to the blessing. Said, woman, you fell. Let's just stay in this realm for now. But you will produce a seed that will redeem all mankind. And then with man also, he said, you're not destitute. He said, from the ground, he said, you're not gonna work for nothing. He said, you're gonna get bread out of that ground. You're gonna get bread. And it's gonna produce, and it's gonna give life, and it's gonna feed. So I want us to see not a failure here, as always, but there's a plan here. There's always been a plan. And this is like the cycle, this is the plan, and this is what God is doing to make man in the image and likeness of God. There's a working out of salvation here, right? So with that, nakedness did not come from the fall. Nakedness was before the fall. So what was the fall? You and I being aware of the nakedness and not knowing what to do with it. That's what it is. So we read that in Genesis 9. It's a recreation. It's a new birth. Isn't that funny or interesting? Maybe it's not funny, ha-ha, but it's interesting. That you see the nakedness of Noah, and you see how the one son, the one realm, the one way of seeing life, the one son looked at the nakedness of Noah, looked at the nakedness of his father, what the other two do. Did not, but covered it. And that's talking about the nakedness of all mankind. All mankind has always been naked. One day God's going to trust us to open up our eyes so that we'll see it, or be aware of it and know how to cover it. Because there's a difference of looking at the nakedness as Ham, as it's spoken of Ham. Ham looked at the nakedness, saw the folk, the fallenness and the brokenness and the demise, if you will, of Noah, of mankind. Now, you could look at life that way, as if there's a brokenness, there's sin, there's something that's wrong, or you could see God and know the very purpose in life is how you respond to it, and always go out through all humanity, and maybe God will trust you to be the ones to clothe all humanity when they become aware of their nakedness. What do? Just cover it. Cover it. How do you cover it? Lots of ways, man. Sometimes you don't repeat it to another person. Sometimes you don't talk about it. Right? Sometimes you just offer forgiveness or love or protection, right? There's no judgment in regard to God's going to get you. Come on. Please. Please. If that's the way God thought, we'd all be burnt to a crisp right now. Boom. Poof. Every one of us. Every one of us. And maybe God wants to show us that we need to go into the world and cover the nakedness of humanity. So with that, I'd like to read Galatians and see how that's going to help us interpret some more of this Genesis 9. Why don't you turn? Maybe I'll read a little bit. Let's see. Let's look at Galatians chapter 5. Verse 1 says this: "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ," what has Christ done? "He has made us free." What are we told to? Stand in that freedom, man. Stand in that freedom. "And do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage." What was the yoke of bondage? It was the works, man. I, Paul, say to you that if you become circumcised, Christ will profit you nothing. "And I testify again to every man who becomes circumcised that he is a debtor to the whole law." Now, it's talking about the flesh here, the flesh realm. But I think that lines up with Genesis 9. And it says you don't live according to this natural realm where the Jewish religion, they said you need to follow all of these laws in order for you to be holy. You want to be holy? You got to, the Jewish law. The men had to be circumcised, and they had to abstain from certain foods, and they had to live. And Paul says that you don't become holy that way. And he said, "I want you to stand in the liberty." He says, "You are free. You are so free." And you know what? You're free. I tell you what, man, it's crazy. But you're free as Adam and Eve was before they ate of the tree. There is freedom. Even in our nakedness, there's freedom. Because God wants us to understand He's got us covered. And there has to be a certain acceptance of that. Because if there isn't, are you guys okay? You guys understand? If there isn't a certain acceptance of this nakedness, you and I will be tormented all of our days until we get this nakedness out. And the answer is never about getting the nakedness out necessarily. It's always about adding forgiveness, if you will, to the equation. And I think God wants to set us free somehow. Because, you know, God says he set you free from the power of sin and death. And in our religious carnal thinking, we think that means that I'll no longer have sin in my life, as defined, you know, in our Christian terminology. But that's not it. The power of sin is broken in my life when I still involve myself in these acts, but it doesn't condemn me. It doesn't bring me shame. My nakedness does not bring me shame. You see, Adam and Eve had nakedness, but it brought them shame after the fall. Before the fall, their nakedness didn't bring them shame. You know, I think God's trying to teach us something, show us something here, man. Because that's our life right now. That's our world right now. You know, it's just the world. And this is how God deals with the world. And He says, "I want you to stand fast in this freedom that you have and stop thinking that you have to do a bunch of things to be holy." He says, "You're already holy. You're mine. You're covered. You're free." And if you walk in that, these other things will fall out of our lives, you know. So he says that. He says, "You become entangled. You have become estranged from Christ." It says, you who attempt to be justified by the law. You can never be justified by the law. It says, you have fallen from grace. Now, falling from grace is not sinning. Falling from grace is not accepting the forgiveness of the sin. Can you hear that? Does it matter to you? Matters to me. It changes the scripture. It changes my world. It changes your world. Falling from grace is not sinning. Falling from grace is not being able to accept the forgiveness of that sin for you and anybody else. And if you've fallen from grace, where do you go? You got nothing, man. If you ain't got the forgiveness of Jesus, you got nothing but torment. Oh. Yeah, we've all lived it. Okay, for we through the Spirit eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. You got to wait for these things, guys. You have to wait for these things by faith. You got to trust in God. It's going to be all right. God's going to work it all out. I have no power, but I have faith in God. When Paul asked three times for this thing to be removed out of his life, God said, I'm not taking that thing out of your life. I'm going to make you a better man. I'm going to cause you to live by grace. And sometimes you and I both know, maybe I know it, but I hope you know it too. Sometimes I feel like when you walk in grace, you're stronger. It's not like when you think you lived the perfect week that you're strong. It's when you know that you had a lousy week, but you had a revelation of the forgiveness of Jesus. Some of those days I have walked in the power of God, you would think that I was a saint for like a month. But I knew that was my worst week yet. And I discovered the forgiveness of God and said, okay, God, let's go. Let's go. Because it's all God then. Because you know very well, I had nothing to do with you. I know. In that realm, I am a wretch, but God so chose. So, let's go. Now, he's not going to trust you with this information until we know how to handle nakedness. And that's what we see here with Ham. All right, I might look at the rest in a second, but what did God say to Ham? This is the infamous curse of Ham. The infamous curse of Ham. But it's the same curse you see in Genesis 3. This is the curse. He says, when Noah awoke from his wine, and he knew what the younger son had done to him, looked upon his nakedness. It said, then he said, cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants he shall be to his brethren. Pause. That's the curse. A servant of servants. All right. You're going to know why I'm laughing in a second. Do you know that one of the titles of the Pope, the guy living over in Italy, one of his titles is a servant of servants? Do you know that one of the titles of Jesus Christ is a servant of servants? Do you know the teachings of Christ says, if you want to be the greatest in my kingdom, I want you to be the servant of who? Paul. Sounds to me like the servant of servants is the blessing. Because what Ham did that day was he looked upon nakedness and he tore down whomever, his brother, if you will, Noah, his brother, if you will, and looked upon or looked down upon his nakedness as if he was higher than, I'm just taking this to a spiritual place, higher than that nakedness. He exalted himself above the other one. Because the two humble sons knows very well, we're all the same, and I will graciously cover my father with absolute respect and honor. Because I know that that's my father, that's where I came from. If he falls, I fall. If he rises, I rise. They say, we are one. To cover his nakedness is to cover my nakedness. To cover his shame is to cover my shame. And it's like Ham was the one that came first, like in the garden. And then shame was attached to nakedness. But then Christ came, and I see that with Shem and Japheth, then Christ came with the proper covering and said, no, we're not looking at this. We're covering this up. And what they did was truly served humanity, truly blessed humanity. And what Noah said to Ham is, you know what you're going to do? You're going to get this blessing back in your life. Because right now you're living for yourself and your flesh and your carnality. But it says you will become the servant of servants. And you will serve your brothers physically until you spiritually have a revelation that you are the servant of all. And that curse, if you will, as you see in Genesis, was the process of bringing redemption. And God works in all kinds of ways, man. I've seen God work as you have, where you've looked down upon certain, let's just be clear tonight. You look down on certain sins in life, there's certain sins that you look down upon. And then God puts it in your life somewhere. Maybe it's you or your son or your daughter or your cousin. And then all of a sudden you don't look down on it so much because it's attached to a person whom you love. And all of a sudden you're not looking to expose the nakedness so much. But now you want to cover it up a little bit. Now, I'm not talking about, you know, winking at sin. You know that. Talking about covering humanity, I'm talking about forgiveness. Leave the rest in God's hands. You don't think people know that they need forgiveness? We think they don't know, so we got to tell them. The Spirit of God tells them. I'm not in charge, and neither are you. Their heart tells them. I don't care what their words say. I don't care what their words say. They can beat their chest and say, I'm right, I'm okay, but I know that their heart tells them. And they might arrogantly say that I don't want to be a part of this or a part of that because they don't think they'll be accepted or loved or forgiven. You know that?